Why has a halt in just squeeze I eye and Jack and suit knock in Neskin plus Quask, why can limp plus squeeze? I introduce myself in my language, Okanagan Salish. My Indian name is I eye, my given name is John Cyrus. I'm from the Caldwell Confederated Tribes, and my tribes are Okanagan and Wenatchee. And I also thank you for coming. I'm all glad that you've come here today. And I think, you know, one of the things that I would really like to start off with, so that it doesn't get lost in some of my speeches, I go off on tangents, so I want to make sure that we completely understand, you know, the importance of having diversity and telling stories that are important to us, but given what we face today in society, those stories get drowned out in the face of what's sensational or what sells newspapers or sells ad times. You know, it's very important for us to uplift and support those avenues that provide a platform to tell stories, diverse stories, stories that touch our heart. I really like the Reverend's, when we started off, he talked about 2 ears and one mouth. That was one of the first stories that my grandmother taught me. When in the wintertime, when we tell stories about our chapitos, our ways, our stories, we have 2 ears and one mouth. We need to listen twice as much as we speak as young people. And that chapitos, literally, now people refer to them as coyote stories and things that the animals are trying to teach us lessons on how we need to treat each other, how we need to interact with one another. And my aunt, who works for the language program, she gets angry when she says, you know, they're not coyote stories. Sinclip was a bad person, you know, and we see, you know, some of that played out today in the media, because when we read each other, we say, stemas bus, what's in your heart? And we speak from the heart. We don't speak from our head, because sometimes, you know, different animals in that kingdom have different attributes. We have a brain that's very smart, but it's also can be so smart that it becomes coyote, and we trick ourselves into thinking we're too smart. And she always would tell me, you need to be careful. Don't let that coyote take over your actions or what you're doing. You need to remember coming from your heart. And she would also, my aunt would also talk about that literally that word chaptiquos in a lot of ways what I see what the fig tree does. It literally means, when you translate it, it's the embers of life, that knowledge of life is a fire that's burning. And when you tell those stories, you're breathing life into those embers as you pass them down to the next generations. So it's a beautiful language that both, when you introduce yourself, when you say you're Sukunakim, you're saying you're from that place where the water comes out of this area. It identifies you, you know, the type of water you're in, what you do in those communities. And then when you speak from your heart, you're speaking to a truth that has been passed down through you. A lot of the times when I talk about our cultural ways, our cultural traditions, it's applied science over thousands of years. So when we use cedar roots to make baskets, or when we harvest a salmon or a deer and we analyze that animal and we look at the fat layer, those animals are telling us things about our environment today that we need to prepare for, that we need to use. So stories don't just come from humans, they come from our animals and from our environment. What inspires me about the fig trees is it's asking us to look at all these stories that are out there that aren't being covered. But I think as we go forward, we need to always have our hearts and our minds open to those things that our environment is also speaking to. I have the privilege of working on fish passage efforts at Chief Joseph and Grand Coulee Dams to get salmon up into those colder waters in Canada. There's thousands of miles of habitat up there. Salmon is one of our first foods that provided, one of the first animals that stepped up and offered their bodies up for the new humans that were coming to this world, and offered them up in love to provide sustenance and medicine for the people. And it's in that relationship we have with those first foods, we have the duty and the obligation to provide for them, that we can provide good, clean water for their families to grow and flourish. So it's, I really see the fig tree, and I thank the fig tree for highlighting some of our efforts around this passage. Understanding as we go forward and face climate change and face these changing conditions we're under, how can we rely on those stories, those diverse stories that we have to make a better road, a better path for us all to walk together in balance. Said many times when those elders, when we get up and talk, we're standing on the shoulders of our elders because of the language and the stories that have been passed down to us. And we honor those elders when we share the knowledge, when we share that information to each other. I think it's so important that that one lesson that they pass down to you is that when you have this information, when you have that language, when you have those salmon that you were able to take, it's important for you to share that. You need to share that. Otherwise, if you hold on to it for yourself, you're being stingy, and that is not the way we are. We don't hold on to things. We're not greedy with our stuff. We make sure we share that. And when you share that love, that gift that was given to you is then passed on to the next generations, the next folks. So, I won't take too much time, but I really want to thank Mary and thank the Fig Tree for providing an avenue for all these different stories to be told and to share, so that we are in a better place moving forward together, that we can build a stronger community. So with that, I say, Lynn, thank you from my heart.